The first person that I want to introduce to you is the co-founder of mediaX and the co-founder of our parent organization, the Human Sciences Technology Advanced Research Institute. He's a mathematics educator. You probably will recognize his voice because he is the math guy on NPR. But he also believes that math is fun. And he's co-founder of a new company called BrainQuake that is thinking about a new way to segment audiences based on, guess what? Mathematical thinking. Keith, welcome.
Okay. So we founded BrainQuake about 2 years ago now and started working in earnest about 18 months ago. And this is what we do. We build casual games that are built on genuinely conceptual rich mathematics learning that deliver deep mathematical fitness insights via a bunch of proprietary algorithms that we have developed and are developing. The title of the talk I gave was, I think, something like, what is our market and what business we're in? Obviously, we're 2 years down the line, we've got investors, we sort of know what market we're in, we know what we're doing. But I want to talk about some of the thought processes that we went through and some of the ones we're still going through in terms of who we are marketing to. Because there's an issue if you're trying to build software systems aimed primarily at the middle school level. Our sweet spot is middle school level because it's where most people give up on mathematics. So it's the one that needs them, where the impact will be greatest. But there's essentially no market there. I mean, you can't sell into that market. There's a textbook market, quite a good one, but they dominate the educational landscape. So there is essentially, and many companies have tried and failed. I'm not the only company that's tried. My company is not the only one that's tried to be in this space. People have been doing it for years. There's essentially no way of making a living, I mean, sustaining a company by selling into the school system. It just doesn't work because it's dominated by the large textbook publishers. Okay, it's hard for a small textbook publisher to break in for a software company. It's essentially impossible. So you have to build your business side around something else other than selling to schools. Okay, and that's really what I'm going to be talking about. That's the premise. Let me first of all give you an example of the kind of thing I'm talking about. Okay, we bought that out in September. It was meant to be a soft launch. It was meant to be a free download because we were using this to find out about our potential market, where the opportunity to make money. Unfortunately, I'm not an unknown person, and within 10 hours of the thing coming out, Forbes had a huge review, declared us to be one of the best available. We were reviewed all over the place, so suddenly this was being talked about. It did mean there were fairly quick downloads, which helped us to get data, but in terms of a soft, quiet launch, it just wasn't going to work. On the other hand, we did find out an awful lot about our users just by using publicly. People don't have to sign in for this. It was a free download. They could just do it. But because of we use a company called Flurry to provide our data, our user data. And because many people on Flurry use other software systems for which they do sign up, Flurry cross-references and actually gives you quite a bit of demographics about who your users are. So within a couple of weeks, we knew the kinds of people. We didn't know their identities, but we knew their rough demographics, where in the world they were, how old they were, what their genders were. So we had a pretty good sense of who the audience was and how long they were playing and whether they were coming back. So very quickly, within a few weeks, we sort of knew who was liking this. We also, the release version in 75 puzzles went from that first little example you saw, the first turn of the wheel, that would be, a child of 6 or 7 could do that one, and many did. The next one, you actually were into the middle school level. The last one I saw, showed you, that one took me about 45 minutes to solve. I mean, I showed the video and I speeded it up, but that was actually quite difficult. Because beneath what looks like a pretty little game, we've actually got a representation of algebra, different and alternative to the traditional one. Because one of the ideas that lay behind all of the games we're developing is the recognition that mathematics is changing its nature and how it's done and how it's learned according to the available representational technology. Mathematics changed fundamentally in all those respects with the invention of the printing press. Well, you fast forward from the printing press to a tablet which is touch sensitive, and you can expect massive changes, and indeed massive changes are possible. So the whole idea was to say, how can we present mathematics and how can we solve mathematical problems using a touchscreen tablet, an iPhone or an iPad or whatever? How can we present and do mathematics? How can we learn it in a way that's different, with different affordances? And things that used to seem difficult can seem easy, and vice versa. As an example, that particular one, with just two wheels and a bunch of things, that actually is a representation of that system of simultaneous linear equations. It's mod 65 because we only have a 65 wheel. But it's the same mathematics, and you're actually solving it. Here you're solving it dynamically and interactively. There, you have to learn and decode the system in order to do that. But it actually is the same mathematics represented differently. That's just a different representation. That would not have been possible before tablets. That would not have been possible before the printing press. I mean, people knew how to write, but they didn't write because it couldn't be securely copied. People couldn't copy and duplicate it. So when you did algebra in the 9th century, you wrote everything in words. So symbolic algebra was a product of the, you know, what we think of as modern mathematics, that's a product of the printing press. It was a technology-dictated thing. Well, new technology, things change. All of our products that we're developing are based on that principle. Take something that looks like this and find a new way to represent it using this technology. Okay. And one of the reasons we want to do this in the educational space is there's massive evidence going back to the early 1970s that says when people in a real-world context who do not think they're doing mathematics actually are doing mathematics, they very quickly reach 98% proficiency. Ask the same kids the same mathematics presented on a piece of paper, and 98% drops to 37%. It's what I call a symbol barrier. It's all to do with how it's presented. If the mathematics is presented in terms of apples and oranges and money and so forth, people do fine. If you present it on a piece of paper, they don't. The representation makes a huge difference. This is what happened at launch. So one of the cute things we saw, this was a quote that we loved, I think it was on one of the reviews on the App Store or on Google Play, Angry Birds meets Lumosity for maths. That suggests we're hitting casual gamers on maths, and we're hitting the brain training people, the people who are worried about getting Alzheimer's, which is a very big market, all the way from young kids all the way to the top. Develop Online said it was the most important. So we got a lot of good press. Okay, we felt good about that. And as a result of that, things started to happen. One of which was we got into the second ever cohort of an incubator in San Francisco called CoLab, which was a joint venture of Zynga.org and New Schools Venture Fund. And more particularly, we were given office space and some money. And the office space was in the Zynga headquarters in San Francisco. Other than having to drive up 280 to get there, the upside was that we had access to Zynga's notoriously famous, or famous, not famous, really famous data analytics people. I mean, Zynga was incredibly good at mining their audience data and finding out how to attract the maximum and keep the maximum numbers of users. And for 4 months, we had access to those people, to advisors, on looking at our data and understanding who the market was, what our market really was. And boy, did we get lots of data. I mean, we just got tons of data. And so we really did know a lot about who was interested in this game. It was a free app. I mean, we've got another version came out very recently that's for pay, so there are this business models beginning to come into play. But the first one was a market test. It was to see whether a bunch of questions we'd asked ourselves, what the answers were to those things. And what the answers was, we could go in many different ways. I mean, we have data that says we're certainly in mobile gaming. We didn't release it as an educational game, we released it as a game. We wanted to see how does it stand up to Angry Birds. The answer was for a few days it stood up very well, and then Angry Birds sort of dominated because it's big. Okay, but we got the good answers to that. We were clearly potentially in that space. So we're in, you know, we can at least look at very big markets, assessment market and supplemental education. Now obviously, you know, you don't go in all these directions, and we still have a pretty clear idea of where we're going to go. I'm not going to tell you what it is, because we are trying to build a company after all. But these are all possibilities that we can, and one of the things we can do is, as we keep bringing stuff out, we can look at the data, and based on the data, we can keep seeing, you know, do we make a push in this direction, do we make a push in that direction? So this is dynamically assigned market segmentation based on the data we've got in essentially real time, because the data comes in within minutes of putting a new version up on the App Store. So it's very, very quick, and the trick is to just keep looking at it and seeing where are we showing strength. Well, we came out in this space. I mean, that was clearly where we began. We are in mobile gaming. We are in the consumer space because there isn't a viable market in the educational space. We can't, we're too small to go head-to-head with Pearson or Apple or any of these big companies. We've just got to do our own thing. And within that space, again, the data told us we were appealing well beyond that initial middle school that we were sort of aiming at. So questions we're asking ourselves, constantly asking ourselves, is, you know, in terms of the market, I mean, things that we're going to charge for, you know, we do need to make money pretty quickly. There's a limit to our investors' patience. We need to start making money. So the question is, where within the space that we're in are we going to be looking? In the case of the people who are playing, many different ways of carving them up in terms of age, both at school and adult. With young kids, you can charge for apps because their parents buy them. For adults, you can charge for apps. For middle school kids, you can't. The last thing if you wanted middle school is for your parent to buy an app for you. It's guaranteed you're not going to play it. So middle school is the black hole of marketing for kids. But parents, if it's a math game, parents can buy it. We can also segment in terms of mathematical level, how hard they are, what level of difficulty in terms of mathematics. And again, we can look at the data to see how kids respond to versions we're bringing out. We can look at the different categories of gamers. We can carve it up that way. One of the things that we know we've got is, you know, the biggest single grouping in casual gaming is the middle-aged mum, with some time on her hands when the kids are at school. You know, in other words, we're sort of bunching up against the Candy Crush market. Or what was the Candy Crush market? I guess that's going down, but... many ways we can carve it up in terms of gamers, including teachers, because one way to get into schools through the consumer market is market games that teachers buy to take into the classroom. And we know that teachers took our first game and moved it into the classrooms. And there remain school systems. You know, we as a company can't sell to the school systems, but if we get enough of the market, in any case, then we could talk about maybe partnering with someone who can get into the school system. So there are still opportunities for getting there. Those two, we sort of launched with those in mind. I mean, the whole launch platform was meant to sort of test those. These, well, we have some answers, but the question mark actually isn't our question mark. That's because I'm not telling you what we're doing about those things. But these are all options. If you're interested in more, that tells you a little bit about the company, and that tells you a little bit about the game. And the first one is still a free download, so you can have fun playing the game. And if you really are a type A personality, and this is Palo Alto, so everyone in here is a type A personality, the challenge is to solve all 75 puzzles by 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. There is a young 14 or 15 year old boy in Berkeley who did just that last fall when I issued this challenge. His father is a computer science professor at Berkeley, and this kid solved all 75 puzzles by the next morning. Now we've got a metric.